let's look at the question, should we use the pooled variance t or Welch's unpooled variance t in inference procedures for two means? Recall the pooled variance t procedure assumptions. In other words, the conditions required in order for these pooled variance t procedures to be valid. We first needed independent random samples from the populations of interest, or the method works for randomized experiments as well. We also needed normally distributed populations, although this is not very important if we have large sample sizes. And we also required equal population variances. The Welch unpooled t procedures also have these first two assumptions, but the Welch procedures do not assume equal population variances. Here are two advantages of the pooled variance t procedure. One, it is an exact procedure, meaning the underlying mathematics works out perfectly if those assumptions are true. Second, it is consistent with other common statistical procedures, like analysis of variance and regression, meaning if we use the pooled variance t procedure, our conclusions would be exactly the same as if we used one of these other procedures instead. Some disadvantages of the pooled variance t. It has this added assumption that the population variances are equal, and this assumption is unlikely to be perfectly true. And it can perform very poorly for some violations of this assumption, meaning we can get very misleading results if we use it in the wrong situations. Some advantages of the Welch or unpooled t, that it does not require the assumption of equal population variances, and it works much better than the pooled variance t in many situations. It can perform much better than the pooled variance t for some violations of that equal variance assumption. Some disadvantages of the Welch or unpooled t, it is only an approximate, not an exact procedure. The degrees of freedom formula is a little complicated, and it is not consistent with other common statistical techniques, like regression and ANOVA, meaning our conclusions could differ a little if we're using the Welch procedure or if we're using one of these other common procedures. In my opinion, the fact that it's an approximate test and not an exact test is not a big deal in practice. It's also not a big deal that the degrees of freedom formula is a little bit complicated because we typically carry out the calculations using statistical software anyway. But what I do find mildly troubling is this one, that it's not consistent with these other very commonly used procedures. In order to understand the differences in performance between the pooled and unpooled variance t procedures, we're going to have to look at a couple of questions. First, how poorly does the pooled variance t procedure perform when the population standard deviations are different? And if the population standard deviations are different, then of course the population variances are different as well. We're going to investigate this using simulation. We're going to simulate a sample from each of two normally distributed populations and calculate a 95% confidence interval for mu1 minus mu2 using the pooled variance t approach. And we're going to do this 100,000 times. And then we're going to find the percentage of these 100,000 intervals that actually contains mu1 minus mu2. Here are the percentages of intervals that contain the value mu1 minus mu2 in a variety of situations. For all of these situations, the population standard deviation of group 1 was set to be 10. The values given in the table are sometimes called estimated coverage probabilities, although they're given here as a percentage, and they estimate the true percentage of intervals that would contain the value mu1 minus mu2 in that situation. The short version is, if the value in the table is close to 95%, then the procedure is working quite well. But if the value is far from 95%, then the procedure is not working very well. In all of these situations, the difference in sample means x1 bar minus x2 bar is still an unbiased estimator of mu1 minus mu2. Where there is a problem, it is because the margin of error gets a little bit messed up. In this middle column, sigma 2 is equal to 10, and recall that sigma 1 is equal to 10 for all of these situations. So in this middle column, the two population standard deviations are the same, and so the variances are the same. And we can see here that the values are quite close to 95%. Theoretically, the percentages are exactly 95%, but there's still a little sampling variability, even with 100,000 intervals. In this top row, I'm letting the standard deviations change while keeping the sample sizes the same at 10. And we can see here that when the sample sizes are equal, the percentages that contain mu1 minus mu2 are actually quite close to 95%, even when the population standard deviations are very different. So the procedure is working quite well for equal sample sizes, even when the population variances are different. But what happens when the sample sizes are different as well? In this bottom left corner, we have that situation. In this bottom left corner, we've got the situation where N1 is less than N2, and sigma 1, the standard deviation of 10, is greater than sigma 2. And in these situations, we can see that the estimated coverage percentages are much less than the stated level of 95%. So the pooled variance method isn't working very well here. I'm going to state, without proving it, that the reason is that the pooled variance standard error will tend to be too small in these situations. And so the margin of error of the interval will tend to be too small, the interval itself will be too narrow, and the true coverage probability of the interval will be less than the stated 95%. In the bottom right corner, we have the flip side of things. We have the scenario in which N1 is less than N2, and the standard deviation of group 1 is less than the standard deviation of group 2. In other words, the group with the smaller sample size also has the smaller true variance. And what we can see here is that the estimated coverage probabilities are actually much greater than the stated 95%. And I'm going to state, again without proving it, that the reason is that the standard error of the pooled variance T procedure will tend to be too large, and the margin of error of our interval will tend to be too large. The interval itself will tend to be too wide, and the true coverage probability will be greater than the stated value of 95%. Note that this effect gets worse as the standard deviations get farther apart, and it also gets worse as the sample sizes get farther apart. The effect is more exaggerated for sample sizes of 10 and 40 than it was for 10 and 20. Here we have a situation where it's performing very poorly, with a true coverage probability closer to 68% than 95%. I'm not showing it here, but the Welch procedure would have coverage probabilities close to 95% in all of these spots. So the Welch procedure would be working well in all of these scenarios, but the pooled variance procedure performs very poorly in some of them. Some points to note. The pooled variance procedure can perform very poorly when the population variances are very different. And the problem is worse if the sample sizes are very different as well. One thing I didn't show, but is true notwithstanding, is large sample sizes do not save us from this problem. So we saw the situation where one sample size N1, say, was 10, and the second sample size N2 was 40. And if we were to increase those, let's say an N1 was 1,000 and N2 was 4,000, this would still be a problem for those large sample sizes. Another point to note is that it's really the ratio of sample sizes and standard deviations that's the issue here, and not the absolute difference between them. So if we had sample sizes in one group of, let's say, 1 million, and in the other group we had a sample size of 1,100,000, we would consider those two sample sizes to be quite close together, even though they differ by 100,000. Another natural question that arises is, what are we giving up if we use Welch's T when the population variances are equal? If the population variances are in fact equal, then the pooled variance procedure is the best procedure to use. But what are we giving up if we use Welch's procedure instead? To answer that question, let's look at another simulation. For this simulation, the assumptions of the pooled variance T procedure are perfectly justified. We have independent random samples from normally distributed populations, and I set the population standard deviations, and therefore, of course, the population variances, to be equal. In this simulation, I've calculated the pooled variance margin of error for a 95% confidence interval for each sample. I also calculated the Welch margin of error for a 95% confidence interval for the same sample, and I took their ratio for each of those 100,000 samples and then I took the average. And we can see in that table that the average of that ratio is greater than 1 across the board, meaning the Welch procedure results in a larger margin of error, which is bad. But it's not that bad, and we can see that this ratio is actually fairly close to 1, and as the sample size increases, it starts to get quite close to 1. What are some points to take away from all of this? We give up a little if we use the Welch procedure when the population standard deviations are equal. We saw in that last simulation that in these situations, the Welch procedure tended to have a slightly larger margin of error. But the Welch procedure can perform much better than the pooled variance T procedure when the population standard deviations are different. How much better depends on how different the standard deviations are, as well as how different the sample sizes are. Of course, in the real world, we're not going to know the value of the population standard deviations, but we are going to know the sample standard deviations. And one should be very wary of using the pooled variance approach if the sample standard deviations are very different. And very, very wary if the sample sizes are very different as well. Opinions can differ on which is the best procedure to use in a given scenario. The Welch procedure is a little bit safer in that it works well in a wide variety of spots, and we could be very far off if using the pooled variance T procedure inappropriately. Overall, we're probably a little bit better off tending to err on the side of caution and choose the Welch procedure if we have some doubt. But it is a little bit troubling that the Welch procedure is not consistent with other commonly used statistical procedures like regression and ANOVA. And once again, opinions on this matter do differ.